These words ring as true today as when Dwight Lyman Moody spoke them more than a century ago. D.L. Moody believed that God could mightily use anyone whose life was fully surrendered, even someone like himself, who was born in obscurity, raised in poverty, and notably uneducated. God did mightily use him. Seldom has there been a man so consumed with a passion for souls. Just think of it. In the days before radio, television, and the internet, Moody preached to more than 100 million people. He was the foremost evangelist of his day, despite those meager beginnings. D.L. Moody was born February 5, 1837, to a far from prosperous family who lived in what is today this handsome country home in Northfield, Massachusetts. His father, Edwin, a brick and stone mason, and Betsy, his mother, raised 9 children, of which Dwight was the 6th. When Dwight was 4 years old, his alcoholic father died suddenly, leaving the family penniless. Moody's earliest recollections were clouded by hardship, yet he claimed that the family's lack of resources strengthened their faith in a God who was faithful to widows and a father to the fatherless. At the age of 17, Moody became weary of life on the farm and restless for adventure. Packing his few belongings, he boarded a train for Boston, a city ripe with opportunity for a young man of his uncommon determination. Taking a job as a sales clerk in his uncle's shoe shop, in just 3 months, he became the store's leading salesman. Earning money soon became the most important goal in Moody's life, but God had another plan. A Sunday school teacher named Edward Kimball felt impressed by God to call on young Dwight and inquire about the condition of his soul. Kimball went to the Holton shoe store and told Moody of Christ's love for him. There, in the back of that shoe store, the future great evangelist gave his heart to Jesus Christ. Following his encounter with Christ, D.L. Moody was an entirely different man. Though his heart still burned with ambition for business, Moody's zeal for evangelism was equally powerful. He loved to talk with people about Christ. By autumn of 1856, he headed west to seek his fortune in Chicago. A tireless worker and an exceptional salesman, he brought the same relentless energy to his spiritual pursuits as well. As Moody prayed and studied his Bible, he also was learning the importance of evangelism. Perhaps it was because of his own desolate childhood that as Moody grew closer to Christ, he found himself drawn to those most often overlooked by the churches, the destitute young men who lived on the streets, and the ragtag children of the slums. Using pennies and pieces of candy, he bribed children from the worst part of the city, a district known as Little Hell, to attend his Bible classes. It wasn't long before he organized his own Sunday school, first in a rented saloon, then later in North Market Hall. Moody's unorthodox methods were so effective that by 1860, attendance reached 1,500. This caught the attention of President-elect Abraham Lincoln, who paid a visit to see the model program for himself. That same year, the call of God was so strong upon Mr. Moody's life that he resigned his job and dedicated himself to full-time Christian service, not as an ordained minister, but as a devoted layperson. The outbreak of the Civil War brought D.L. Moody face to face with human pain. In 9 trips to the front lines and in countless camps and barracks, Moody offered comfort to the wounded and dying, and earnestly pleaded for the souls of men. After the war, Moody and his new bride, Emma Revelle, returned to a flourishing ministry in Chicago. Ever attuned to the needs of the city's teeming population, the visionary Moody felt God's leading to start a church. The Illinois Street Church was the forerunner of the great Moody Church, today still one of America's foremost pulpits. At a time when pews were usually rented or bought by wealthy parishioners, the sign at the Illinois Street Church read, ever welcome to this house of God are strangers and the poor. The seats are free. Today the Savior calls, for refuge fly. The storm of justice falls, and death is nigh. Those words sung by Ira Sankey the evening of October 8, 1871, were strangely prophetic. For indeed, death was nigh for many that night. Ignoring the sound of the fire bell, Moody preached a moving message. However, as Moody left the meeting, he saw the flames engulfing the city, dooming many of the souls he had longed to reach. Dwight and Emma lost everything in that fire, their home, their possessions, the church. Only this portrait, rescued from the flames by Emma Moody, survived the great Chicago inferno. In the years following the fire, Dwight Moody devoted his energy to the great evangelistic campaigns that would take him throughout the United States and around the globe. He moved great crowds with his simple stories and then brought them into the very presence of Christ with his Spirit-led preaching. Now, there were those who labeled him a heretic, but the hearts of the common people were awakened by Moody's down-to-earth presence. The Holy Spirit was clearly felt, and thousands upon thousands committed their lives to Jesus Christ. In 1875, D.L. Moody moved his family back to his boyhood home in Northfield, Massachusetts. He built a house of his own and added on to the four-room farmhouse still occupied by his mother. As Moody walked the verdant New England hills he loved so well, God spoke to him about the need to train and equip a new generation of Christian workers. A masterful fundraiser, Mr. Moody threw his energies into launching the schools he would later call the best pieces of work I have ever done. First, Northfield Seminary for girls, and then Mount Hermon School for boys. No sooner had these opened than Moody turned his attention to an even more ambitious project in burgeoning Chicago, establishing the school that would ultimately be known as the Moody Bible Institute. In contrast with the divinity schools and seminaries of his day, Moody's Institute emphasized practical training in urban evangelism, world missions, prayer, and the use of Scripture to transform lives. Moody combined his efforts at the schools with his still prodigious evangelistic work. At the 1893 World's Fair in Chicago, D.L. Moody and his students led a revival that touched nearly 2 million lives, putting into practice the shoe leather evangelism for which Moody Bible Institute is still known for today. Someday you'll read in the papers that D.L. Moody is dead. Don't you believe a word of it. At that moment, I shall be more alive than I am now. Moody's words preceded his death on December 22, 1899. In keeping with his wishes, no dirges were sung at his funeral, no black crape adorned the doors, and sunlight streamed through the windows in celebration of Christ and the resurrection. God had used Dwight Lyman Moody, not because of any special training or talent that he possessed, but because of his total surrender to Jesus Christ. His passion for souls birthed an earthly legacy that endures to this day, a church, a world-renowned school, and a publishing company that bear his name, and an eternal legacy in the millions of lives he touched with the gospel. Though Moody lived and worked a century ago, his story still reveals to the world what God can do with one woman or one man fully consecrated to him.